So we have Karen Scrivener with us. She's a professor at EPFL in Lausanne, Switzerland. And according to me, she is really an authority on microstructure, cement chemistry, and material science of cement-based materials and concrete. And I admire her a lot for her determination and tenacity, and more than anything else, for trying to make science easy enough for people to understand, even in industry, because she doesn't stick only to her lab space, but she talks a lot with industry, and we are very happy to have her in India many, many times every year. She is obviously a leader in her field, and she is the reference person that we can go to when we have problems or doubts in material science. She has also put together a network called NanoSem, which has done a lot to propagate and bring together people who work in nano and micro analysis and understanding of materials. She is heading a major project that we are happy to be involved in, which is LC3, which is on limestone calcined clay cement. And there really she is going the whole stretch from the understanding of the microstructure to looking at how such a cement can be implemented and used in practice. So Karen, welcome.
Thank you
very much. And we are really grateful that you could give some lectures to our students. So one thing I'd like to ask is, why material science is important, or why should, or how should we encourage people to get into material science of concrete?
Well, I think it's really important for looking at the challenges we have today. I mean, maybe if we had unlimited resources, unlimited energy, and no problem with global warming, it wouldn't be so important. We could just continue to use materials in the same way we have been using. But we know that, you know, all materials, concrete included, we have productions of CO2, which is contributing to global warming. We're running out of materials. And if we're going to tackle these challenges, we have to look to the materials and how we can use these materials better. So you always say how we can do more with less. If we're going to do more with less, then we really have to understand what's behind the way these materials behave, which is the material science of these materials. So I think it's very much in today's context that we have these limitations, that we need material science to better answer them.
Certainly. And I think, and I expect you would agree, that our curriculum also has to change, because we've been looking at structural design as the backbone of how we deal with concrete in the curriculum. We don't talk much about the material science, the chemistry, and what is the basic building block. And that probably also has to change in the curriculum and how we teach.
Absolutely. I mean, 20 or 30 years ago, the only type of cement anybody could buy was ordinary Portland cement, which was pretty much the same wherever you were. Now you've got the choice of, do you use a pozzolanic cement? Do you move to an LC3 cement? Do you stick with Portland cement? And how can you possibly make an informed decision on that if you don't understand what the differences are between these different materials? So again, you know, if we're going to have any chance of meeting these challenges facing us, we have to educate our civil engineers differently so that they understand this. And, you know, I don't think it's that difficult to do. I mean, we have intelligent people who can do very complicated mathematics and structural equations. I don't believe that those same people are not capable of understanding the basic chemistry. It's just the question of education and giving them the right information. So I really hope that, you know, this kind of lecture like we're doing here can make some contribution to that.
Well, you've been working on this for a long time. We use some of your graphs and images and pictures in our classes from going back to your PhD work. Now, have things changed a lot, and have people appreciated more that you have to bring about this understanding?
I think so. I mean, I think there's there's several components to that. First of all, I think we're really making a lot of progress in getting to the bottom of the underlying mechanisms. So whereas 20, 30 years ago, we kind of said, oh, we don't really know what's happening here. Now we really know what's happening. Secondly, by the creation of NanoSem, we've really brought together the industry and convinced them that they need to invest in this fundamental research. And I think that's had two consequences. First of all, it's given funding to enable us to find out a lot of these mechanisms. But secondly, the industrials themselves have become then much more interested in the answers. And a lot of the people we've trained in NanoSem through PhDs are now in the industry. And that all helps the tremendous increase of knowledge I think we're seeing. Of course, there's a long way to go because that's a sort of trend we've started in Europe, but that needs to spread more widely. We have to work on changing curriculums. There's still many more things to do, but I think we are making progress.
A lot of times when we go to funding agencies, they say, what is new in cement and concrete? Yeah. We've done it before. Everyone knows how to do it. So is there a short answer or is there a way to convince people that there is a lot to do? Obviously, we believe in it, but how do we convince?
I think more important than there's not a lot to do, we have to convince people that there's no miracle out there. Mm. Sometimes, I think that people have the illusion that because we've seen such rapid advances in things like microelectronics and things like that, that there's some kind of miracle solution that's going to come and solve everything. But when we're talking about solid materials, we're really confined by the composition of the earth. And we can't change that. So there's no miracles out there. And we know what's in the earth. We know what are the possibilities to do. So funding agencies have to appreciate that you have to work in reality. We discovered 400 years ago that alchemy was an illusion. You cannot turn base metals into gold, or at least not without a nuclear reactor, which we're not really going to be interested in. So we have to work with real materials, and therefore it's more important to go deeper with materials which we're using already than to think that some magic potion's going to come along which is suddenly going to solve anything. And I think that's kind of difficult for funding agencies to realize that even though you're sticking with the same basic materials, you can still make considerable improvements.
Would you make a prediction on how long or how many more years we'll continue to use cement and concrete as the most important construction material that we have?
I don't think there's any I can be absolutely 100% sure I'll be right on this. It will continue to be the most used material forever because there's nothing that can replace it on the scale we need to house people. Mm-hmm. So, it's difficult for people to understand this, but there really is no alternative that can enable us to live in cities with motorways and everything like that as we do in the modern world. If we wanted to go back to living in mud huts, well, then we wouldn't need cement and concrete. But I think most of us don't really want to go back to living in mud huts, however romantic it may seem occasionally.
So having said that, where does LC3 fit in?
Well, LC3 is really, I think, something with tremendous potential to meet these challenges, both of global warming of CO2 and resources. We can continue to really make substantial cuts. I think we can realize another 20-30% reduction in CO2 emissions worldwide. 20-30% emissions on cementitious sector would be equivalent to 1-2% of all the emissions of everything. So that's pretty significant when you consider the amount that's coming from the electricity production and everything. Secondly, it can help us meet this resource challenge because the world, we have a lot of limestone, for example, but there's increasing resistance to open up new quarries. Of course, people don't want to, they want land to build on or for agriculture. They don't want it for exploitation in quarries. And with LC3, we can reduce the amount limestone needed for making the clinker, and we can also get rid of a lot of materials that are in the minute stockpiled as waste. We have huge spoil heaps in clay quarries that these can be reused in cement. We can also get rid of another problem and rehabilitate those other quarries.
Good. Thank you very much, Karen. Always a pleasure talking to you.
Well, thank you, Ravindra, and it's been a pleasure to be here as always, and hopefully they'll get something from these lectures.
I'm sure they will. Thank you.
Thank you.